Hey there everybody, this is Snoo. I got one hell of a video for you today, straight from the bank. It took me a while to get all of these, all of the currency funds to produce this farming strategy for you. Lo and behold, 400 winged scarabs and a whole bunch of sextants, a whole bunch of crimson temple maps. You know, this is quite similar to a farm I've been doing for the past many leagues now. I can't seem to get away from it because I have a confession to make for you guys. I kind of like min-maxing the fun out of the game. That's what's fun to me. I like testing all kinds of different strategies, seeing what works, what doesn't work. Quite often, many things that turn out to be really great. Sometimes they synergize really good with other things. Sometimes they don't. And I do as much testing as you see me do live on Twitch, on stream, in YouTube videos. I do even more of it off stream, surprisingly. It's not every day that I'm going to say something like I'm about to say, but because it's risky, a certain amount of risk in what I'm about to declare, but I am going to stake my claim in this video. I feel confident enough in saying that this is the most lucrative farming strategy, mapping farming strategy of the entire league, Sanctum League. I'm going to talk to you about it. About why that is. And of course, we're going to run the maps. We're going to see what the results are. This is a strong box divination card farming strategy on Crimson Temple. Nothing new there. It involves Harbinger, Shrines, and Delirium. Nothing really all that new there. Harbinger a little bit. I was already doing this strategy all the way back in Sentinel League. The moment they introduced the Apothecary card, I did 1,000 maps testing. Essentially, this strategy, very small variations there, but basically this strategy, I tested it out in Sentinel League, 1,000 maps. With the help of the Sentinel mechanic, I earned in excess of about 25 to 30 divines an hour. Or I guess it was exalts an hour, wasn't it? Actually, yeah, exalts an hour. At the time, surprised a lot of people, but I knew that it was so good that I wanted to prove it to everybody, that just how good it was. So I ran 1,000 maps of it, and I kind of got a sense of the drop rates of the Apothecary card. Fast forward to the following league. Once again, I started off doing the strategy. It was very lucrative. Again, people started thinking maybe the Apothecary card was selectively nerfed, but there was a lot of conjecture on that. Insert God Touch Farming definitely took my attention away. It was a lot of fun. It was great. Right before the league ended last league, I took a step back into the Crimson Temple and did the pure strategy, the pure divination card farming strategy I did. And much to my horror, almost, it was even more lucrative than any God Touch farming strategy that I came out with that league. And you guys know just how good that was. This was still more lucrative. Again, without the help of Sentinel, I farmed an excess of 30 divines an hour, effectively normalized apothecary drops, based on the presumed ratios, which I think I should probably go ahead and tell you here. You can see here, I am going to be referring to this resource. I know some people maybe believe or don't believe this resource. This is an estimated divination card drop ratings based on an enormous, almost million stack decks. A test that was done by the community back in Sentinel League. I'm delighted to tell you that Surgog, a very, very well-respected member of the community, has actually made a video fairly recently talking about some of the resources that are available to people that have helped us understand some of the backdoor information that is hard to find out. He referenced this exact resource, which will be linked in the description below, and he gave it his thumbs up. He believes it's quite good. I also believe it's accurate. Maybe a few very minor exceptions to it. The apothecary drop rate, obviously, very well, not 100% certain. But if you go through here, I definitely challenge you to take a look at the doctor drop rate, nurse card, and patient drop rates relative to the apothecary drop rate. And I think you're going to see there's a lot of evidence in there that suggests that it's pretty accurate, because essentially, the nurse card, about 7 or 8 times more rare than the patient. The doctor card's about 7 or 8 times more rare than the nurse card, and the apothecary card's about 3 times more rare than the doctor. According to this information here, I don't think it's any more than 3 times as rare as the doctor card. I'm pretty sure. I've farmed patients, nurses, and doctors an awful lot in my day, and of course, at this point now, I've farmed a lot of apothecaries. So while it is exceptionally rare, I still believe in this information here. I really don't think that the apothecary card was ever selectively nerfed as opposed to the other divination cards, not to be confused with the fact that all loot across the board was essentially nerfed back last league, so as far as raw drops. But again, we're only comparing apples to apples here, and so when we're on the apothecary farm, we're kind of looking at the amount of 7 years bad luck and lightens and dragon hearts and apothecaries, trying to figure out everything there. So I'm a believer in this resource. Maybe you are, maybe you aren't, but I am going to be referencing this as a means to identify the currency per hour of this strategy. I have now tested this strategy 3 separate times in 3 separate 48 map runs. All 3 times, this came out to an excess of 30 divines an hour. This league, this farm, right here, right now. So I am 100% expecting this to come out to at least 30 divines an hour. One of those 3 times came out to almost 35 divines an hour, if I got a little bit lucky on some of the unique drops. And again, that is with the apothecary drop rate adjusted. Let's humor the possibility that the apothecary actually was selectively nerfed. It wasn't nerfed by any more than a factor of 2. It's no more than twice as rare as it used to be. That would still be 25 divines an hour, even if that is the case, which I don't believe it is. Let's get back to it here. Let me show you what we're working with on this farm. I think I'm going to start with the Atlas Passive Tree. I'm going to be addressing a lot of different things here. It's going to be a huge amount of value to you guys. We're not just talking about the most lucrative strategy in this league. We're talking about things like Headhunter. Is it any good anymore? Oriath's in the flask. How good is that? Harbingers. How good are they, really, if you maximally invest into them? That's all kinds of different questions I think people want to know, as well as Winged Scarabs. We're actually using Winged Scarabs here in the 5th week of the league. Totally unheard of for me, but it actually turns out to be incredibly lucrative. I'm making something like 20 to 30% more currency per hour just from upgrading Gilded to Winged on this strategy, and there's kind of a reason for that, because there's some pretty awesome synergies between, you know, Reliquary Scarabs and Harbingers and all that stuff together. But here we are. This is the quintessential farm. This is going to look so much like some of my other farms, fully blocking everything to maximize the chance to get strong box ambush to spawn naturally, not to mention shrines or essences as well. Essence is not actually a part of this strategy here, but the strong box, all of it's there. Essentially, all the important parts are there. No need to take tamper proof because the sextant will cover that point right there. Harbinger is in full form here. This is something I don't usually do. I typically don't go full-blown Winged Harbinger and take every single Harbinger node, but again, that's a little bit new, and I do think that Harbinger is sort of filling in the gap. The difference between like 20 and 25 divines an hour, or 25 and 30 divines an hour, is coming from the massive improvement that Harbinger got this league. Compared to last league, I mean, just think about last league was the Dark Ages for Harbinger. It was already got its Exalt Divine Swap, stripped away its value there. On top of that, they introduced God Touch farming and then removed the conversions from Harbinger. Well, we got the conversions back. They are now back in full force with rare conversion loot, as well as the introduction of Fracturing Shards, which, oh yeah, and not only that, but also +3 Harbingers on the map device means a Harbinger's like, this is like triple time improvement to Harbingers. And the crazy thing about this strategy, Harbingers are not even the primary farm. This is a maximum investment Harbinger strategy. Harbinger is secondary farm on here. That's how incredibly strong Strongbox is with divination card farming. And don't get me wrong, a lot of divination cards are going to be popping out of Harbingers as well. And a lot of uniques and conversion loot is going to, but it's still going to be secondary, I promise you. Delirium is basically number 3. I think Delirium needs to be on every single map. We can now get Delirium to spawn naturally on maps around 60% of the time, whether it's Wandering Path or not. Doesn't matter. It needs to be on there every single time. We now have the information about how Delirium impacts the maps. In case you weren't aware, Delirium monsters cannot drop maps. I also think they cannot themselves drop any divination cards. You might be wondering, why the hell would you care about Delirium? It's because Delirium puts an automatic quantity multiplier as well as rarity multiplier, its own separate multiplier, onto the monsters at a rate of roughly 50% increased, 50% more quantity or rarity. Go look up Delirium on the POE Wiki. You can see the exact numbers on there. It's not an insane amount, but because it is its own separate multiplier, it is pretty huge in its own right. It scales linearly. The difficulty of the monsters scale exponentially, but the quantity and rarity scale linearly. And it is a modest amount of increased loot. And it makes a huge difference when we're already putting so much increased quantity onto the maps via 8 mod corrupted maps. Yes, this is an 8 mod corrupted maps with its full quant wheel, quantity rarity wheel, increased effective modifiers and non-unique maps, as well as going the Eater of Worlds. I don't even really care to talk about Divine Orb Altars anymore. I haven't seen one in a long time, but that also could spawn, and it'll certainly be in the highlight reel if it does spawn in this session here. And that's about it. It's actually quite simple. Oh yeah, Shrines is also on here. Shrines is not a huge deal. It helps a little bit with the borrow player power. I don't really need Shrines in order to get by. But the chance of a Covetous Shrine spawning as well as blocking everything means I have a bonus 20% chance to spawn Domination onto the map. Means I think Shrine is a nice place to fill the rest of the points. You do have some flexibility on Shrines. So when I say this is the most lucrative strategy, I'm really talking about Strongbox in conjunction with Harbingers, with Delirium Mirrors, and as well as going 8 mod corrupted maps, and yes, not doing Wandering Path. Probably the biggest question I've been getting recently, what do you think about Wandering Path? What about Wandering Path? Get more cards? I have tested it. I've tested it extensively. In fact, yes, I do actually get more divination cards per map with a Wandering Path setup, slightly. About 0 to 5%, maybe 10% at the very high end, more cards than the setup. One of the big issues with Wandering Path, the real elephant in the room with Wandering Path, is it makes the map so much harder that either you have to start restricting the modifiers of maps you run, such as 96% reduced recovery, life recovery, which absolutely sucks, as well as some other things that come about on Wandering Path, or you have to settle for the fact that you're just going to die more often. Now, you could offset that by having an extraordinarily strong and expensive character, but if you're investing in character strength, that means you're investing out of Magic Find. So that's another thing. This is a Magic Find hybrid character, and that is part of how I'm able to farm so much currency in here. This is not your standard Glass Cannon all-in Magic Find character. It's not your standard no Magic Find character. This is somewhere in between. I have, let's actually see how much I have here. I got, 45% and 100%, but that's not accurate. Let me show you right here in real time how much this is. 61% quant, 142% rarity. That's actually 202% rarity if you count the, for conversion loot anyway. It was rares and unique drops. That's what that looks like on there. So you can see that I don't have some insane amount of quantity already, but I got a very nice healthy amount. And this is, of course, I guess in essence, going to showcase the Tornado Shot Champion Magic Find Hybrid while we're at it. Now, a couple of last recent changes that I've done to the strategy is putting points in here in Paranoid Fixation as well as Imagined Pursuits. These are also some somewhat flexible points. I like the idea of getting an extra layer of Delirium Rewards and some more Delirium Rewards. Basically, this is the difference between 6 versus 7 Delirium Rewards, which it does equal an actual 4th bonus reward type tile as well. And also, Paranoid Fixation is actually really nice because the strong boxes quite often spawn Rogue Exiles, which are unique monsters. And, you know, it's not all that unusual to see a Delirium Orb just suddenly pop out of a strong box effectively because of the monster that dies there on it. So that is it. That's a strategy. It will be linked in the description below, of course. No singular focus. Kind of even on that. I don't think singular focus is playing a huge role in, you know, increased number of currency drops or, you know, whatever the maps. It's kind of a give and take there. I will be have a chance to drop a Cortex or Conquer Influence maps off of the boss or the unique Crypt. Cursed Crypt maps also drop, unique museum maps also drop on there. This is the favorited system I have. I have Atoll favorited a lot for its value for running Sanctums. Oh yeah, I actually finally finally got a sanctum that is actually somewhat valuable. This is really cool. Increased skill effect duration is actually super nice with Immortal Call and Val Haste. So probably not going to replace this anytime soon unless I get a really good relic on there. Just kind of a side point. If you want to see the character, POB is linked in the description below. This is going to look quite familiar to you guys as far as my Tornado Shot Ascendant or Tornado Shot Deadeye did last league. All right. So I do plan to run a map at some point in the highlight of the map showcase. I'm going to show you what it looks like to not have the Orion's End versus to have it on there. If you're really curious about the power of Headhunter, I suggest you go take a look at my Sanctum run where I foolishly walked into the Sanctum with this exact gear set that was not tailored at all for bossing or anything like that, and just go see how laughably bad my DPS is in there, and then take a look and see how good my DPS is in here at 50 Headhunter buffs. You can also kind of just look at the very beginning of any given map. You're going to see myself with like almost no Headhunter buffs and having a little bit of a hard time getting that ramp up to start, but I'm still a huge believer in Headhunter. I know Mage Blood is super good, even though I've never actually used it. So I can't authentically compare Headhunter to Mage Blood. While the restrictions to the viability of Headhunter have been shrinking and shrinking and shrinking the last few leagues, if you have a well-geared Tornado Shot or any physical to element conversion attack-based build, and you're doing high-end juicing with a ton of rares on the map, you're going to get a lot of value out of Headhunter, and it probably is still the best belt you can wear. Here it is. We're doing Elevated Strongbox. This is effectively about 13 chaos for an additional strongbox on the map as opposed to its unelevated version. This was kind of a last-minute change. You don't have to use elevated here. You can use unelevated. I do think one strongbox is worth 13 chaos. For me at this point with this level of juice, but if I was using Gilded Scarabs, I wouldn't do it. It costs a Divine Orb each for this one. Second up, we got the Enraged Strongbox sections at a price tag of around 110 chaos per each one. I tell you the price tag now so you can sort of verify the amounts. That's what this Divine Orb chaos amount here. It's covering the cost of the compasses as well as a few other things that we'll talk about here. And yeah, I need 25 of these compasses to run this strat. Now, you could run Elevated on this, but it's an outrageous price tag. I believe it costs, when I did the math, it was effectively something like 22 chaos per strong box without receiving the actual benefit of the strong box itself. If you sort of compare the value of 500 versus 600% increased item quantity, there's essentially 10 or 11 strong boxes on each map. You can do the math there. You're effectively getting something like, you know, two extra openings of a strong box for the cost of 50 chaos. Probably not worth it going elevated on that. Harbinger is another one. Again, this is an all-in Harbinger strat. We can't really do anything that is going to impact Harbinger in a bigger way. That means one of the cool things about this video is you're going to get to see just how often Fracturing Shards drop in a fairly reliable. I mean, this is a big enough sample size. We really are going to get a pretty solid sense of just how common Fracturing Shards are. And of course, I do have a chance of getting a Mirror Shard as well, or full-blown mirror potentially from this. So of course it's kind of hard to count those things. They are extremely rare, but it goes without saying, when you're juicing things up this much, especially if you involve a reliquary scarab, you never know what happens. The tier zero drops do really have an actual chance of revealing themselves. So this is one cool thing about this farm that I like, is that it's very fun and high stakes. Let's see, we got Delirium Mirror, which is extraordinarily cheap this league. It did actually cost me 20 chaos a piece for this sextant. Oh yeah, the Harbinger, I think, was 32 chaos a piece for this sextant here. Now, the Scarab, sometimes I include an extra cost in there for the difference of the bulk pricing versus single pricing if, you know, Awakened PoE is inaccurate. Actually, this is pretty accurate. The Awakened PoE pricing is pretty accurate. These Scarabs cost around one. I was able to get 10 scarabs for the price of one Divine Orb. Not these exact scarabs. Now the Divination and Strongbox scarabs do cost more, but it doesn't matter because you can just swap scarabs now. very easily for almost no price. So essentially, a winged scarab only costs as much as the cheapest winged scarab on the market. Now, more or less. Now, as far as Crimson Temple maps, these are all 8 mod corrupted. Most of them do not have quality on them. Well, some of them do have quality on them if I manually rolled them. A lot of these were farmed up through a different strategy, which I will feature in a following video. If you're impatient, you want to know how I did it. Basically, I did the same strategies I did on the colony. There was some small variations with changes to the Atlas passive tree. But I did a colonnade strategy featuring 8 mod corrupted map drop. You can actually just revert to the Wandering Path version of this strategy and get like 10 or more maps per map as well. So that is a possibility there. But I like doing it on Colony because it unlocks Legion, which I think actually offers the most or the highest map return potential. Looking forward to making that video, but I don't have it ready for you yet. And that's about it. Oh, one last thing to mention. I guess there is actually an active market on 8 mod corrupted Crimson Temple maps. Whereas I don't think buying the maps is very smart, because you're only going to get whatever the player is willing to give you, his worst selection of 8 mod corrupted maps. But at any rate, I'm going to value these maps at roughly 8 chaos apiece. That's what they're selling for. They default to around 3 or 4. I added 5 chaos apiece for each one, so that was also included in this massive investment cost, which is... still remains the same. All things included, 27 divine orbs, 40 chaos, all the winged scarabs and the maps, their default cost anyway. Grand total, 76.88 divine orbs. That's a pretty high investment. Not the highest investment I've ever done, because actually the winged scarabs are cheaper than they've ever been before, at least relative to the power, the currency power of a divine orb. But that is where we're starting right here. So look forward to this gross and net number later in the video being a lot higher than this number. I promise you it's going to be. For anyone who's sitting here thinking right now, I bet you he doesn't even make his currency back. You're out of your mind. I'm going to make my currency back and then some. How am I going to make my currency back? Well, divination cards. It's of course normalizing the apothecary drop rate. Gambler cards are on my loot filter. 449 gambler cards equals 1 apothecary card relative to the information that I have on that Excel spreadsheet that was done by the community members a couple leagues ago. Also, I'm going to be getting a ton of loot from the Reliquary Scarab. You might be thinking, why would you run a Reliquary Scarab? Isn't Magicfine dead? That's another big concern a lot of people. Magicfine must be dead. So here's another great thing we're going to showcase in this video, that Magic Find is not dead. You're going to see tons of highlights of conversions, different things. I will, of course, highlight some of the biggest drops. We're going to see currency conversions of, you know, hopefully multiple Divine Orb drops. We're going to see a bunch of Winged Scarab, Gilded Scarab explosions. We're going to see tier 1 uniques that are worth in excess of 1 Divine each. I just had an Aegis Aurora drop 2 maps ago when I was warming up for this strategy, because I actually did warm up this morning. I did 4 maps, and one of those 4 maps dropped an Aegis Aurora. I expect to see more of those kind of drops in here. There's a lot of different jewel drops that are worth a lot more this league than in leagues past that people are just kind of completely overlooking. But it is very interesting that this is a combination winged divination, winged reliquary scarab, which means it is basically the most grandiose, highest stakes kind of farming strategy you could possibly have. We have a very real chance of seeing a Mage Blood or a Headhunter drop. There's multiple 10 to 20 unique belts that drop in every single map. We have chances of Mirror Shards to drop. We have chances of Apothecaries to drop. Raw Mirror to drop. I don't know. It's going to be fun. of course, we'll kind of all figure it out. As far as actual tier 0 drops, I'm not going to count those in full for this strategy, but I have yet to see what actually drops. So, you know, you can move over to the timestamps, see the results if you want, if you're impatient. But I bet you the highlights on this video are going to be something to behold. So let's get into starting this up. Gonna move everything over, put my currency away. Hey, I'm suddenly floating 27 divines. Isn't that nice? Like I said, it was hard to get all this stuff together. I've been I've been throwing a lot of my currency into my new Sanctum gear setup. Stuff means I'm never floating any currency. It all goes straight back into my character. Oh yeah, this character is worth about 2 mirrors right now. I'm still not sporting a mirrored item. My next major upgrade will be a mirrored bow. But you know, you might be thinking to yourself, well, okay, wow, Snoo, you made 30 divines an hour. I can't do that. I don't have this character. I don't have this build. I don't have this internet connection or whatever. Well, look, I'm just telling you, these are going to be the results of what I'm capable of doing when I set things up this way. And there are plenty of people in my community who are able to basically mirror what I'm doing here. And if you are not yet, well, I mean, you can work towards it and you can just, I guess, make a little bit less over a little bit more time. Not that big of a deal. It's still going to be an exceptionally lucrative strategy for anyone who, at the very least, doesn't suffer bricking these maps. Of course, it is kind of hard to do these maps with the Deli Mirror and holding it back, but the King Harbingers provide a great opportunity to hold the mirror back. Actually, I should mention that right before we get started. Wandering Path, another major problem with Wandering Path in this strategy, the Deli Mirror gets way, way harder to do. First of all, you get a lot less bonus time with a Wandering Path setup because you can't take Singular Eternity or Descent into Madness, for that matter. But then also, there's no King Harbingers. So every time you kill a King Harbinger, you get like 45 seconds of free time where the Delirium Mirror pauses. That doesn't happen with the Wandering Path setup. So it changes the dynamic of the map. You lose some of the value there, having to do things outside the Delirium Mirror. It just creates a much more stressful mapping experience. And if I'm going to run 100 or 1,000 maps or whatever, I probably ran about 500 maps of this strategy now this past week, I don't want to stress out too much over it, if you know what I mean. All right, enough chit-chat, let's get to it. We got map number one, Crimson Temple, a nice map, minus maximum player resistances. Not so bad if it's not Wandering Path. It's not minus 20%, it's only minus 11%, right? We're going to go all the way down, and we're going to have a whopping 11 Harbingers on each map. Now, this would be a great opportunity to probably use the Master Mission, but I'm still not going to do that because it's not something like a major focus. If you were to use a Master Mission, I mean, Alva would be okay. Einar, I think, is actually better. I've seen some evidence of Einar conversion loot being exceptionally good. So I think this could be really nice. We're ready. We're going. Map number one. This will be timed, of course. One more thing. If you're kind of behind the curve, you don't have the character power to do this thing, look into my shrine juicing strategy. It was a perception versus reality video I made. There's a whole lot of added player power and much easier to manage that strategy than this one. And you can definitely get your foot into the door with that strategy. As opposed to this right here, this is for somebody who already has a very, very strong character. So here we go. This is... I'm not going to take Orias' end off here, but you can already... Oh, that's nice find. Yeah. Game over. I guess the Reliquary Scarab's worth it. Right off the bat, Red Star from a raw unique. People have been talking about uniques and magic finding and just how bad it is now. Guys, go look on PoE Ninja and just bask in the glory of just how valuable so many different uniques are. People talk about like, oh, you know, the second week of the second day of the league, third day of the league, uniques aren't valuable anymore. Oh no. Not good. Oh, I just died, by the way. Did you see that? I guess I should probably pay a little more attention to what I'm doing instead of talking the whole time. That's okay. If I die early enough, it's actually not that bad because I don't lose too much of the mirror. But if I had died like that, first of all, I would have definitely died right there on a Wandering Path setup. Way, way more likely to die. But with the normal setup, I can go in with my Magic Find hybrid character and probably survive most situations. I think I'm at least like 5 times more likely to survive a given situation in a non-Wandering Path setup. I mean, that's how much difference it is. But this is obviously, yeah, a pretty dangerous room. Trying to stack up some Headhunter buffs. Now I got 21 suddenly, so things are looking a little more up. Definitely not invincible with any number of Headhunter buffs like usual. So again, that is the difference. Difference from before. But here we go. That King Harbinger was inside the boss room. It's dead. That just gave me about 45 seconds of time to move around. I know the Delimir has already moved a bit, but you see, I'm running past the strong boxes, and some of you probably don't know why I'm doing that. If you have a character like this, a really strong character, well, then you can kind of skip around and do things this way. but have a little bit of a problem here with the Delamere. As you can see, it moved a little farther than I thought, so actually now I need to ramp things up and go ahead and bite the bullet. I would like to unlock all of the Eldritch Altars, to get all of the packs or quantity and rarity multipliers before I drop this. It's not just about divination cards, it's about raw unique drops as well. So map a little bit scuffed here, map number one. That's gonna happen, but more often than not, I will successfully, you know, clear a full map under the full effect of the delirium. And so you just have to wait maybe for map number two to see that. So every strong box I open is now not under the effect of the delirium, which means I'd no longer get that separate multiplier of the delirious. It does make a difference. If you've ever ran a strategy like this, you've probably noticed that you see more divination cards, more loot in general when you're under the delirium than not. It's not just a feeling you have, there is actual math behind that. And again, if you want to see it, type in delirium into the POE wiki, read all about it. They got some updated information on it. I believe it's accurate. And yeah, go about your day. Now, one nice side point, if you do lose the deli map and it's a hard map and you're afraid you might brick the map, well, losing the deli just made the map instantly a whole lot easier to do. So that's always nice. Quite unlikely to die when there is no delirium. Now, Burning Ground may have something to say about that. I usually run the Burning Ground Pantheon, but today I'm running Soul of Ralakash because I'm not even Corrupted Blood immune. Believe it or not. It might be hard to believe, but couldn't fit it in. I'm missing the Mantra of Flames. We don't have that jewel anymore. That's really unfortunate, but oh well. So a much longer than usual map. Most of these maps will be around 4 minutes, I think. But the map one's always really long because I'm talking, not focusing, maybe dying, and not warmed up either. There we go. I think we're done now. All right. So not terrible. Now, you know, if you get 5%. Hey, that's a good find. Now, excellence is only going to count this as a baseline brass dome. Now, this brass dome right here is actually worth a lot, because it's 5%, it's worth over four divines, but it's only going to count it as 50 chaos. So there are some manners in which the excellence detecting the amount of currency I have in here is overly conservative, which goes against my, you know, the findings in the end when I suggest, you know, how much currency did you make? Well, I probably made even more than what excellence is going to tell me. Believe it or not. I'm also going to count delirium or cluster jewels. We have a quite a decent chance of getting maybe an S tier cluster jewel, like a 84 plus 3 passive mana reservation small cluster, for example. That's worth multiple divines. I will be counting things like that because this is a full-fledged delirium farm. So here we are. We're going again. I am extra vulnerable now because I have a Covetous Shrine. The Covetous Shrine is actually pretty insane, though, giving me a whole bunch of extra quant rarity. In fact, I think I will do you the treat after we're done with this boss room and I get some headhunter buffs and I'm not almost dying. Let me come back here. Let me actually do this map right. So here's what I like to do. I will go down, start doing one of the wings. Diamond Shrine, super strong with this build, too. I love the shrine power here. It's just hilarious. Strong. There's a King Harbinger here. Almost killed me, actually, right there. Oh, King Harbinger in the hallway. never a safe bet. Try to run through that. But I need to kill this guy ASAP. I need to get that mirror frozen again. It's already begun to move. I've already lost a little bit of time on there. It's probably entering the second room here. Let me come down here. Right here, maybe. Okay, actually, I did a little better than I thought. Okay, let's take a look here and see where we're at. 83% quant. Now, you remember the number before. It was 61%. So you may have to go back and catch that timer. But if you saw on the character window there, it said 83% quant. So I went up by 22% quantity. I went from 61 to 83. That's pretty crazy. I have increased effect of shrines on here. And if you're wearing a Gull Helm, well, then you actually get even more than that. So Covetous Shrine's not going to show up every map, but it does have, I don't know, maybe like... Let's see, it's probably going to be on average two shrines. Two or three shrines per map. So it's probably be an average of 15% any given map. Double Nurse from Diviner Strongbox. Also another jackpot hit. I didn't even mention when I talked about the jackpot tier 0 potential. You know, we could very well see a duplicated House of Mirrors drop from a Diviner Strongbox. Yet another source of potential jackpot finds. And another reason why I like the non-Wandering Path variant, because that would have only been one Nurse card if we were doing Wandering Path. Wandering Path does have some advantages, though. One of the major advantages is a 12% chance to reopen the same strong box, so you're effectively getting more strong boxes on the map. Although that kind of evens out with the loss of an automatic strong box from the Atlas Tree Notable. In the end, I think it comes out basically even. You're also missing all the blocked chances to spawn ambush naturally on the map, so things kind of even out that way, but... the pack size is bigger, certainly. Definitely a little bit bigger. This pack size on this map is, what, like 55%, I think? So Wandering Path tends to be, for me... you know, if this is 55, a Wandering Path would have been probably 65%. So it is more, and it does ultimately result in a bit more loot. So long as you don't screw it up. Map 2, a much better map. Definitely made my currency back on this map. So who knows, that one strong box might have been the strong box thanks to my elevated sextant, which added one more strong box on the map. I don't know if it was that one or not, but I like to think it was. Running pretty fast here. Wow, over 100 Simulacrum Splinters. I don't see that every day. Simulacrums is not really a big part of the farm. You know, I could put points into that, more points in there, but I don't think it's going to be really much point to do that. So there you go, map number 2 done. Stu over here just opening menus and stuff, yeah. Well, I know when I'm safe and when I'm not. And, well, I'm safest when I'm not talking. That's first of all. Get that out of the way. Oh, yeah, I will be leveling gems on the side. You know, gem leveling, unfortunately, took a massive hit. You're not going to be seeing the crazy temple double corruption enlightens and awakened enhances support out of me that you saw last league. I think one of the worst things that happened is the beast crafting, the automatic leveling of all awakened gems. So that kind of ruined that sort of fun side jackpot thing that I had going on. Unfortunate, but it is what it is, I guess. One full round of enhanced, 9 enhanced gems is going to equal about 2 divines of value if you sort of calculate the chances. 1 in 8 chance of going up, and you look at the cost of those. Free conversion. Maybe it double dips on conversions, actually. Alright, well, there's a conversion over to a large scale scarab drop, which is something we're going to see actually pretty often. Again, that duplicated uniques might work for that if you. Oh, well, there's dupe scarabs. Too bad I didn't take that earlier. Oh, well. Duplicated headhunter, maybe? Just kidding. An actual 7 years bad luck, though, dropped, as well as something else here. Divine, raw divine, okay. Skittering orb dropped from the strong box. You see there, the map is still going on. I still have my delirium effective, so delirium orbs don't just automatically drop right now unless you have that notable that I took. So that was actually a lot of valuable or a lot of value out of that notable, giving me the automatic deli orb drop. And this is still just map number 3. You see all kinds of conversions there happening out of the Harbinger. There's all the evidence you need there. I think that was maybe, I don't know if that was a unique conversion or not. It was definitely a map conversion. That's actually a lot of fun when you're farming 8 mod corrupted maps when that happens. When we're here, it's not that big of a deal, though. Still cool to see. Alright, so you've had a chance to kind of see a little bit about how strong the character is when open the map. I'm going to run this map without Oriath's in. And you're just going to get to see the opening of this map without Oriath's End. I'll plug it in a moment. I just want you to see, you have some sense of the clear with it on. So let's kind of see if the clear is much, much worse. Probably not much worse, but... I already feel like it's worse. I can't even hardly finish off a rare, apparently. Alright, not too crazy, but... Oh, I just actually took the wrong altar. I had an early Grand Eldritch Minions altar, I think it was. Actually, it might have been boss, but not sure. Let's see. It's not going to make a difference right here. But it's kind of weird seeing, like, little monsters... get killed here, and then like the monsters standing next to them are still alive for at least a second. That is a little strange, but I don't know. I don't see a crazy huge difference, but I do believe the difference is there, and it's going to be worth messing with in the end. It definitely comes out ahead when you're juicing it up this much. Might be a case for not using that flask if you're doing kind of lower end stuff. It is pretty expensive if it's well-rolled, like the one I have. Rusted Harbinger skin. Nah, not gonna be rusted. There it is, a unique museum map. I talked about that. It's 30 chaos just in the bank right there. Oh, look at this map crank up to beyond the status of a Wandering Path map. Uh-oh, what do we got? Nico, damn. Keep an eye on. I passed Grand Eldritch Ikers again there, but that's fine because we were at the very end of the map, so I would have still done that anyway. But here we go. We got Covetous Shrine. We got a lot of quantity altars from the map, so this is a highly juiced up potential map here. As I open up all these strong boxes, I like to wait until I've already done them, ran the map, and gotten all the altars, because the altars are going to have a multiplicative effect against the quantity of these 500% increased quant strong box. So the combination of Delirium, 500% quant from the Strongbox, as well as, like, what, 250% increased quant from the map. This is pushing 2,000% increased quantity when you multiply all that all together. And it starts to make a lot of sense as to why Strongbox farming is suddenly say, the number one way to get divination cards. Well... That appears to be a double 7 years bad luck from the Strongbox itself. Yes, it does stack up that way when it's in this way. And so that is, again, another case to be made against Wandering Path. You're not going to see that happen on a Wandering Path map. Just not. You can't do it. Crap ton of explosions about to happen in the middle of somewhere. I might avoid that, but... Oh, double divine from the Strongbox. Again, another drop that goes against the narrative that Wandering Path might yield more loot. There it is. I'm really shoving it in the face of those Wandering Path antis, aren't I? I don't have anything against Wandering Path, but my god, when you see the double loot from the Strongbox itself, time and time again, I mean, you start to think to yourself, maybe I should not do Wandering Path. Oh yeah, somebody mentioned in the chat, very, very good point. Wandering Path restricts some of the alternative... mechanics you can do. You can't do Abyss anymore worth a damn. Abyss used to be pretty good with Wandering Path. Now it's terrible. Harbinger? Hell no. You're not going to do Wandering Path Harbinger. I did test it. Yeah, it's way the hell worse because no king Harbingers. They spawn with half the speed, no automatic conversions, no automatic Harbinger as well. Way, way worse. So Harbinger takes a huge hit if you try to do Wandering Path style. Really, the notables are way too important for this. And since Harbinger is pretty obviously the clear winner, I mean, it was a clear winner two leagues ago when we didn't even have Harbinger shards or Fracturing shards. Anyway, yeah. Kind of have to do it this way if you want to do Harbinger. The rarity code convert? Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's... otherwise, I would have started seeing some major... Oh, four Fracturing shards. What? Hey, why is that not a red star? That's stupid. I gotta go in there and change that. Should be a red star. First Fracturing shard drop fairly early on. People are wondering if Fracturing shards are affected by quantity. We're led to believe through the community that player quantity probably does not affect Fracturing shards. Not actually killing the monster itself. It's a slightly different mechanic. But map quantity does tend to affect literally everything that drops in a map. So probably the 8 mod corrupted map version with, you know, 208% increased quantity thanks to some alters, more than likely is increasing the number of fractured shards that drop. So yet another reason why you might want to opt into an 8 mod corrupted Delirium Mirror style as opposed to, you know, Delirium Orb 6 mods. So sadly, with 63% chance to dupe Div card, that did not get... Oh wait, one more chance. Yeah, it looks like I did not get a Divination card. I'm a little sad about that, but... it could be worse. I could have found a duped Enlightened card. I'd rather find nothing than a duped Enlightened card right now. I get PTSD from that. Oh, I love this chest. Highest chance for a dupe Divine Orb drop. Yeah, that hallway would have scared the shit out of me on a lesser geared character. Or if that was like the first thing I ran into on the map before I had any headhunter buffs. I'd been like, whoa. Hey! Are you serious? Man, I mean, you get lucky in some ways, unlucky in other ways. I am like top of the chain. Good fortune on the actual strongbox drops. That is insane. I keep duping stuff out of strongbox. Champion shield. I did mention in the intro that I found one of those two maps ago in a warm-up, and here we are, like 20 maps later. It is. It's not four divines anymore. It's only like one and a half, two. Hey, three more Fracturing shards for a total of four. Two separate Fracturing shard drops on one map. Getting red stars, guys. Pounding me there. Honestly, disappointing there's no winged in this. That was a lot. Wait, do I have scarab dupes? No scarab dupes. Divine altar. Yeah, I got one actually somewhat recently when I was doing Sanctum running. It was a little lame. It was three divine orbs off the boss. So, I mean, I got it. It was nice, I guess, to get 3 divine orbs off the boss. Oh, finally, they have 7 years randomly off the Harbinger. It's funny, that card's coming out higher than the others. It's definitely more rare than any of the Enlightened. I'm not using Domination. I'm using Harbinger. I better be using Harbinger. I'm gonna be mad if I'm looking on here and this is Domination. Red Star, Divine Orb. Second red star, Enlightened. Okay. Starting to see a turnaround. Talking about how weird it was getting so few of those drops. Don't do it. That's what all the best players do. They find one card and they gamble it up to 5. Red Star, duplicate, the Enlightened, out of a strong box, again. Actually, I don't know, we'll have to watch the replay. I do have 37% chance to dupe card. So maybe. And just like that, the Enlightened's back in the lead. Never doubt. Never doubt. Take Corrupted White Atoll all day long. Rain of Splinters. Unique there. A strong box loot auto corruption. Works out sometimes. The second time I found Rain of Splinters, I found one yesterday too. Wandering Path will get you more cards per map by I think probably on average 5 to 10% more cards per map, maybe, but you don't get the. Well, it depends on what. Oh. Wow. I love getting interrupted by that. That's a very nice Nice interruption. Whatever I was saying, just forget about it. I have no idea what I was talking about. You were here, indeed. I'm gonna leave so fast. I don't even collect my deli rewards. That, and actually I don't want that. Get that out of here. There it is! Map number 43. Edwards gifts 5 subs because I guess that's the criteria for me to make money. This is a results-driven stream. No getting paid without results. I actually prefer results-driven income. Like, I'm not even kidding. Not joking at all. I do prefer results. I think getting paid for your time without any results is kind of lame. As someone who, you know, wants to feel motivated to do stuff. So I absolutely appreciate the because it's not a handout at all, right? I earned it. Wolf of War was sad he was not one of the gifted subs, so he decided to sub straight up. That's cool. I see you, Wolf. Feeling a little left out. Yeah. One apothecary. There it is. Wait, did I get any other cards? I don't remember. I mean, right on schedule. Right on schedule, basically, guys. I mean, I'm supposed to have one apothecary every 3.5 dragon hearts, 6-7 years, and 7 enlightens, or somewhere around there. So, coming in clutch. I think this notion that they nerfed the rare div cards is a misconception that exists because they nerfed everything. So anything that is really valuable and rare felt exceedingly nerfed because it was already like noticeably rare. Dragonheart, wow, right in time. I'm supposed to have more of those right now. In fact, that is the card that is behind schedule more than any other card right now. Of course. Dropped. Of course. No. Pop carry. Get out of here. Oh, a bunch of scarabs again, though. Just put the smile on my face. Let's just freaking scarab drop. I have to think the Reliquary Scarab is something for that. Maybe not. I don't even have time to pick them up. Questionable as to whether rusted ambush scarabs should be on my loot filter or not, but I guess. Oh, hello. Wait, was that? No, sorry. Oh, the opulent. Sorry. I was almost excited. Second, I believe that was a strong box, not a currency conversion. My spirits are spent. I don't think it was a loot goblin, because I would have seen a bunch of alc orbs and more chaos. I was looking for the big alc orbs pile. Like, if it had shown, like, 7 alchemy orbs or something, that would have been the signal there, but I didn't see it. King Harbinger in a perfect position. Feeling a little dangerous. Doing down here. I was literally thinking about this when I hit the maps. I was like, man, I don't know, maybe I'll take the cards off the boss. I was like, the Cursed Crypt could duplicate, so you know, you never know, right? Oh my god, even that could have duplicated. That would have been crazy. Get a sense map. But it did not. Well, okay. I guess we're showcasing why Singular Focus may not be the absolute best option. It's pretty funny. And I will have to count these maps manually. I'm collecting them on the side, so they don't show up in excellence like at all. So they have to be counted separately. That's okay. Dragonheart, here we go. Wow, waking up to the second day of farms. Really, popping off fast. That's hype. Gotta D&D myself, though. There we go. Always forget to do that. This is why you're seeing, like, so much conversion loot come out of the Harbinger monsters. If you see these, bunch of scarabs dropping out of nowhere, that's usually from a Harbinger monster. Am I running wandering path? Nope. Alright, they're right there. I'm pretty sure that was from a... Yeah, that was, you know, just killed the Harbinger right behind it. So exactly what I was just saying. Literally exactly what I was just saying a second ago just happened. Massive conversion onto scarabs off of a regular Harbinger monster. These divine orbs I'm getting are just from a strongbox duplicates mainly. Dragon's Heart again. Wow. Dragon Heart starting to pull ahead now. I think Dragonheart's the luckiest card at the moment. Five. Yeah, four, three Fracturing Shards, dude. Woo! Woo! Conquer Influence map also to be included. Would not typically see that with Singular Focus. We'll have to count those manually in the end. There it is, finally. God. Look at this, 90... Wow. Map 96 to finally get that stupid chest. So unbelievably overdue for that. Probably scrolled over at least 100 spider silk chests. Freaking session, man. I see at least 5 every map. That would be about 100. Wow. Just talking about how I really getting unlucky with the uniques. Yeah, it's Covenant. It's worth a bit more earlier this league, but it's still worth a lot. Actually, it's been a long time since I've seen a Divination Duplication Altar. It's been a hot minute. We got a Covetous Shrine and everything. I'm going to make sure that mirror is good to go. Okay. This could be juicy. I got a lot of quant altars. This is a very high quality map. A lot going for me right here, right now. Time that Covetous Shrine much better than that. More quantity. Yeah, Covetous never was able to really lose value because it's just so crazy popular. Poison builds, Chaos builds, this league, and now they did that. Oh, there, it's Dragonheart. Man! Oh, if you ever want something good to happen, just complain to the game. Works every time. Just gotta complain. Keep down, people. I used to think you gotta put positive energy out there, but the more I play this game, the more I complain, the more loot I get. It's just some cyclical thing that takes place. That's how it's done. Well, I got a full set of 7 years bad luck, and then immediately found a raw mirror shard. Yeah. I mean, to be fair, I am targeting mirror shards. It's definitely part of the farm. This is a maximum juice harbinger strat. Can't juice it any harder than this. Not really. Alright, everybody, we got some results in here. Just like we're gonna do this every time, it's the same thing. I got 4 massive quad tabs full of loot. A, B, C, D, all in there, all the way down to the 4th one. And I have a whole bunch of extra things which are gonna be adding a little bit of value to the side at the end. As you can see, there's just a lot of everything in there, uniques, a lot of maps in there. I do think the maps are actually worth something. I sell a lot of maps in bulk, and especially this league with Sanctum, the way Sanctum running, most of the maps in here are Atoll. Definitely worth full value, in my opinion. Here, let's see what we got, and let's see where we got unlucky and where we got lucky, because I had a little bit of a topsy-turvy run. Not terribly disappointed with things. But here is the front sheet on everything you can see here from top to bottom. Let's actually just kind of go through one at a time, I think I'll do. So I pay closest attention to the divination card spread, and you can see one very big number I'm looking for here, which, I think I was almost going to forget to mention, I manually dropped the price or value of gamblers down to 0.2 chaos piece, because that's what they truly are worth. They're worth basically one stack deck. To turn in 5 at a time, and 1,048 gamblers. So that is providing a sort of baseline for when I adjust the divines per hour assessment or adjustment or estimate. That is kind of where I'm getting it from, using that total number of gamblers based on the resource that I linked in the description, the one at the intro of the video, which was the enormous stack deck test run that was done in Sentinel League. With presumably did not change in any sort of major way. There is, of course, again, still a little bit of conjecture about the apothecary drop rate raw, but anyway, I'm still trusting that. I'm still using it. For now, just keep that in mind in case you're super, super against what that resource says. But anyway, I did find one apothecary, so that's happy. I was actually expecting to find at least 2. I knew I was supposed to find at least 2 based on my assumptions on the drop rate. Only got 1, so that's definitely going to mean that things are going to come out a little less than I hoped for in the end. That's alright. I did a perception versus reality video last league when people assumed the apothecary drop rate was nerfed really bad. I found 2 apothecaries there where I actually got a little bit lucky. I think I was only supposed to find like 1.5 or even less in that run based on the estimated drop, but I found 2, and that's just how it goes sometimes. You know, sometimes you find 0, sometimes you find, I could have very well found 0, I could have found 4, you know, you never know. And my chat was sure to tell me, you know, how they were finding none in hundreds of maps, and how some were finding hundreds in no maps, basically. Not exactly, but you know, something like that. 2 nurse cards dropped in the second map. The nurse cards, I guess, in the monochrome was basically the only sort of jackpot diviner strong box drops I got. Not the best showing for that. It's okay. I've definitely had a lot better than that, but certainly a jackpot opportunity there for the diviner strong box didn't pan out in any major way. And then for the major map specific cards, we have Apothecary 1, 7 years 14. That's pretty big. The Enlightened 9. That's actually really low, especially for the estimated drop chance, and then the Dragon Heart 7. So what this tells me is that I already know kind of off the top of my head based on the number of gamblers. I was actually supposed to find right around 14, 7 years bad luck, right around 7 Dragon Hearts, right around 16 Enlightens, maybe somewhere around there, and 2 Apothecaries. But as you can see, the Enlightened and the Apothecaries definitely fell short there. Scarabs were a big part of this farm as well. Oh. And we'll go ahead and kind of let you see here. 21,000 chaos in that. Scarabs. Operative strong boxes provided a lot of scarabs. And so did scarab conversions. Not all of which were featured in the highlights, but many of them were. You can definitely see some winged scarabs were involved. The reliquary scarab, I think, had something to say about that, those conversions. As I understand it, I'm guessing now, because it's changed a little bit, but I saw some polished, gilded, or winged scarabs come out of conversion. Now, polished used to not show up as anything, so I'm thinking maybe when you see a polished scarab from conversion, that might be a magic item converted over, and then gilded would be rare, and then uniques would be turning into winged, is what I'm guessing. I'm not 100% sure on that. Only 2,700 chaos. Not too bad, though, for scarabs, considering it's not any sort of major part of the farm. Just kind of on the side there. Let's see. Currency. 20 divine orbs is actually one thing. Oh, I think I got a little bit lucky. I usually don't see 20, although I don't usually farm Harbinger quite as hard as I did. So maybe that is kind of relatively accurate. But, you know, typically it was always somewhere between 10 and 20 in 100 maps with this kind of juice. But I guess 20 is a little bit closer to what you might expect with full-blown wing scarab stuff. One mirror shard, of course, drop. That's definitely very lucky. I'm guessing I would see a mirror shard. I don't know, maybe probably a few hundred maps, I would guess. Although I'm not really sure, because I haven't farmed, you know, maximum juiced harbingers in any sort of major way ever, really, before. So I'm not exactly sure on that. Of course, another thing that people aren't sure on is how many fracturing shards, fracturing orbs you would get from doing a whole bunch of maps with Harbinger. Now, this is a pretty cool display here, kind of give you a sense of how many you might expect. This is 33 shards. I suspect I got something like a dozen separate drops, which means I should have probably got a full fracturing shard conversion over to fracture orb on average. You'll probably see at least one of those, but did not see it this time. This is just straight up all separate drops, and there's 33 of them in there. I did go ahead and leave ancient shards on my loot filter. Happy I did that, because that's 1400 extra chaos that I have. Not too awful to try and click those, and they all drop all at once anyway. I think I'm a little bit on the fence about whether ancient shards should be on the loot filter, but as you can see, I'm walking away with 107 of those. So for anyone worried about losing currency on a farming strategy like this, the ancient orbs were a super dependable source of income that I made on every single map. Obviously, Awakened Sextants. Of course, I got a lot of Exalted Orbs in there as well, and just tons of other stuff. I never picked up Orbs of Alteration unless they were in full stack. That's kind of crazy that there was 4,200 of those. But yeah, stack decks are there. We'll be messing with those in the gambling portion of the video, I guess. Let's see. We had Divination, Scarabs, Currency, and yeah, that should be about it, I guess. Oh, one more. So, whereas I got probably fairly lucky on the currency side of things, definitely got the worst of it on the unique. So, I did mention that I did some test runs before this, and I was seeing, you know, and I got a natural instinct in one of them. I got the other Viridian Jewels, there were the five divines apiece. I got multiple Covenants, multiple Aegis Auroras in those three test runs of less than 50 maps apiece. I'm super disappointed with the showing here altogether. That's with a covenant that dropped like in the last few maps. I was very, very disappointed. I expected the reliquary scarab to more than pay for itself. I don't know if it did or not. I haven't really done the math on it. Don't think I'll really bother with doing the math on that. But anyway, this is the total value of uniques. 2,700 chaos. But I should mention that that's including, you know, things like this. This is a four divine brass dome, okay? Because it rolled 5%. It rolled 5% on the all res. However, it's just going to show up as 60 chaos, which is just woefully under pricing that item. And that's sort of the story about uniques anyway. This is going to be the absolute baseline value here. A lot of these uniques rolled very well and are truly going to be worth way more. Like the chevrons, I know there's just shavs in here. There it is. 20 chaos? No, that shavs that I dropped was like 80 chaos shavs based on the drop. So there's a lot of misleading values here that are showing up in the unique. So I definitely actually made more currency than what it's saying specifically as far as the uniques are concerned. Total dump tabs here. You can just kind of go through. See them here in case you want a snapshot. It's up to you. But this is everything. Now, for the uniques that are only worth, like, less than 20 chaos, what I'm going to do here in a minute, I'm going to do gambling portion. I'm just going to Valorb everything, because that's kind of the theme of this league, is pick up all the uniques. Sometimes they're worth a lot. Usually they're worth almost nothing, but in many cases you can Valorb them, get an implicit that suddenly makes them worth multiple divines. And there are some uniques in here where I have that potential to happen, and I suspect we probably will see at least one of them turn out that way. Let's go ahead and calculate how much was made. So I know I didn't make 30 divines an hour, of course, because I didn't even find two apothecaries. But let's see how close it came. One more thing. So I did fully level 4 full rounds of enhanced gems, and I'm counting these at 2 divines per round. That is 6 enhanced gems leveled all the way up. Normally I'd be doing awakened exceptional support gems, but apparently you can level those for free now. It's kind of really messed up how I'm going to be doing gamblings and stuff, and as far as double corrupting temples, not really sure what's in the future of that, but for now I'm just still just doing the enhanced gems. It's kind of easy going. The investment's not too bad. If you do the math on the chance, it's like a 1 in 8 chance of going up. If you do the math on the value, the sort of differential between bricking them, nothing happening, going up, I think in 9 gems it's about 2 divines worth of value. So this is 36 gems. I'm going to give myself 8 divines worth of value in gem leveling there. All the cluster jewels here. Also, no major jackpot hits. No 84 plus mana reservation cluster jewels, sadly. But they do still have some value. These are still worth 30 chaos apiece. Conquer influence gems worth about 30 chaos apiece. And got a few other Conquer Influence maps, I mean, and a few other maps in here, and then we got some unique maps that are all worth like 20 to 35 chaos apiece, depending on which map. I am counting those, and if you were doing singular focus, you wouldn't see these. Instead, you'd see maybe something converted into a divine orb, perhaps. I think it's kind of a mix, you know. These all sell. These will all sell very quickly at the price that I set for them. Grand total between the gems and all these maps and cluster jewels, 11.66 divines will be added to the gross total here, and the total said 186.59 plus 11.66. So in days gone past, I would usually get more value of leveling gems. Actually, I would have got way more than what I'm giving myself here, but you know, it's just the state of the game. You know, it's nothing I can really do about it for now. And that's what we're going to write into here. So this is the actual gross that I personally made, basically. And then we take this minus 76.88. That's a big investment cost. That's what it costs to do the strategy. About 188 chaos per map, I think it was. And we got 121.37. This was not some screaming ultra-fast shrine juicing strategy. Killing 11 harbingers does take a little bit of time. And there are a few deaths, of course, when you're dealing with King Harbingers in hallways. And consequently, it took me... I'm still very fast, of course, but it took me about 7.5 hours to do this farm. And it looks like... personally, I hit about 16 divines an hour. So that's pretty good. Let's see, actually just see for fun. Let's do kind of... I'm going to show the adjusted based on how many apothecary cards I probably should have gotten. Real quick here, I wasn't actually going to do this, but I think I'm going to do this. I'm going to take this number minus 58, because that's how much an apothecary is worth, and we're going to see how much currency I would have made if I had gotten 0 apothecaries. Because a lot of people are thinking, you know, 100 maps, ultra high in juicing, you still might get 0 apothecaries, still possible. And I still made currency. And you know what's crazy? When I did the strategy like this with Gilded, it's around 4, 5, or 6 divines an hour. So again, winged is just better all around, I guess. Or perhaps the economy is changing a fair bit. Still making... I'm actually a little surprised that to see a number that high with 0 apothecary drops. And so are you, probably, to see that much currency earned in there. It really speaks volumes to how valuable harbingers are, strong boxes are, just generally speaking, and how everything just kind of works together. And I don't think the Reliquary Scarab was contributing very much to this number. Not this time, anyway. Although it certainly has a chance, and of course the jackpot potential there is just crazy. All right, so that was a little bit of a fun show and tell on what might have happened if I got zero. Let's see what happens. Let's see what happens if I get two, because I think in normal circumstances, I would have gotten two. Based on this level of juice, and you know, I'll show you why in a second here. So if we take this number here, we take it divided by 7.5. So if I got two, I hit around 24 divines an hour. Pretty good number. Pretty good. Not gonna lie, it's pretty good. But we can see here that as far as gamblers, 1,048. Now, if you go do the math on the using the resource, you're gonna what you do there is you're gonna first of all you're gonna see that. You take the weighting of gamblers divided by the weighting of apothecaries, comes out to 449. So we take this number divided by 449, 2.33. So that suggests that I would get 2 1/3 apothecaries. So if we, you know, subtract 1, because I did get 1, and then we take this times 58, and that's where I arrived at this number here, adjusted, so 77 divines. So I give myself 77 divines. On top of the net, that would be what I would presume would happen more often than not. And if I divide that by 7.5, a little bit to my surprise, I don't quite reach 30 divines an hour. A little surprised, because I had done 3 test runs. I hit 30 divines an hour all 3 times. So I kind of thought that was pretty solid. But I definitely get a lot better RNG on the unique drops. On all 3 of those tests than I did this time, like way better. So again, that's where my disappointment in this session comes in the unique drops, not even in the lack of apothecaries. So of course I could have got 3 apothecaries, it would have blown past 30 divines an hour too, but that would not be the average result. So you may think that this is super inflated, not right at all. And if you do think that, I got good news, because I'm going to be doing 1,000 test runs for this. I'm just going to do this strategy basically 1,000 times over. So we're going to get a little bit better sense, because I hear the community is kind of a little bit, wishy-washy on the apothecary drop rate. Did they actually nerf it last league? I don't know. Did they nerf it again this league, or was it carried over from last league? All we can do is just run more maps and just have the best resource I got, you know, which is Sentinel. And I still, you know, having run hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of maps, having my own community, seeing what people say. Many other people run hundreds of maps, find 0. Many people run, 100 maps, find 4 or 5. What are you going to do? You just kind of have to go by the numbers. So this was a really fun farm, so I don't mind the idea of running 1,000 maps. So I'll get to the final thoughts here in a minute, but first I have to do gambling session. So again, for gambling, I'm just going to Valorb all of these, and we're going to see if anything comes out on these. I'll get things set up. We'll go ahead and show that in the YouTube video, I think. I gotta set it up, though. Well. Alright, we are mid-gamble. Divination cards first. Figured I'd go ahead and bring you in while it's hot. The getting's good. I think I already made my money back. Brother Stash always puts a smile on my face. Oh, okay, yeah. I was under the mark for Enlightened. So you got about 5 more to go if I'm going to hit the... anyway, hey, that's a pretty nice turnout for, what was it, like 100 and... Or not even 100. Not even 100. Not bad. I'm not really sure what to me is worth here. Let's see. Brother Stash. 100 chaos. Nice. Dorian's a food. That's a big one. Okay, that's gone up too. Goodbye. Made out like a bandit. Not gonna lie. Okay, I have never turned these into INR before, but we're gonna see all the Ventor's gambles. Gonna 3-1 these. First off, I should probably double check. Make sure that none of these were already well rolled. I do believe one of them had 10% increased quant. Okay, that one came close. I am going to re-roll, though. Yeah, this one. Yeah, I just needed to be positive on the rarity. Yep, None of them are really good enough, so we're just going to go ahead and turn them in. You probably already knew you could do this. It's a 3-to-1 recipe. This is the only 3-to-1 recipe I really mess with in the league, but I do think it's worth doing this with them. Okay, that's all of them. Boom, let's see what we got here. That's a big nope, 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 nope. That's a very low chance of actually being worth anything. Try again. Okay, there we go. Three more. Nope, nope, nope. And nope. Well, one more time. Last chance. Oh. Failed me. Einar, never again. Never turn them in to him again. Oh, okay. I guess I got for good measure here. Let me get away from Einar. He's bad luck. Greetings. Maybe Helena will give me better luck.
Farewell.
Almost. Almost. All right. Yeah, unfortunately, nothing crazy in there, so just get these in here. One other thing that we're going to do before we close this out.
I can't do this just yet.
So this league, especially more than most, many people are not actually match finding at all, so even the sort of low-end uniques are worth, you know, 5 to 10, maybe 20 chaos, which I have many here, and many of those have a certain corruption or two that drive the value to the moon. One of the most prominent examples of that would be a 10% Quant Sedimus touch that rolls elemental weakness on hit. Okay, that goes up to like 7 or 8 divines, I think. There might be a couple other hits on that. A Gull Helm that hits reservation mod, you know, that's, last I remember, that was like 25 divines. So we'll see. I know Cosprey has some obvious potential there. And, you know, I'm not going to be valing a covenant or anything, but I'm going to val all of the uniques are essentially worth about 20 chaos or less. Because I don't really sell anything that much for 20 chaos or less. So let's go ahead and pull this up here. Oh, that's awkward. It's already corrupted. Well, no good, I guess. Here we go. Start from the left. Okay, I'm not even going to look at it. I'm going to check them out after I see them all corrupted. A 5% Quant Bisco's leash would be insane. I bet you that sells for a lot. Alright. Down the line, let's see what we got here. Okay, that's actually big. Percent, yeah, Darisol's Defiance, the best body armor in the game as far as I'm concerned. Just ripping a percent damage mod out of there made that definitely worth something. Fizz damage reduction. Nope. Attack cast speed here. I don't think that's actually worth anything. Let me kind of verify that. Well, actually, it says maybe 30 chaos. I don't know. I guess I'll try to sell it. I know that Vixen's hit temporal. Chains on hit is worth multiple divines. I've had that happen a couple times this league now, actually. Pure talent, 5% area of effect is... Yeah, probably not. Sedimus 2 duration. I don't think that's anything. Nope. Alright, Cosby, nope. Armor Y stationary. That's awkward. Actually, suggesting maybe there is something good here. I don't know. I'll look into that later. Might be a fluke. Nope. 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 Okay. Looks like Biscos. I never have any luck with those. They never change over anything good. Okay. Not seeing anything. Oh, enfeeble on hit. I don't think that's very good. Although, it looks like it might actually be decent here. I'll look into that one later. Socketed aura gems. I don't think so. No. Spell crit chance. Okay, no. Actually, no. Let's see. Moving on. Nope, nope, nope. Nope. Not getting minion gems. Don't think so. That's it. Okay. Not very good, actually. Definitely no jackpot hits there. And yeah. Now the other thing to do is the enhance. Last big one here. So every single enhance that goes up to level 4 is worth, I think, at least 3 divines now. Let's see. This is typically the thing I am luckiest with. Remember, the chance is 1 out of 8. Well, I got it on the 12th try. And the 13th. Okay, there's a down. Another down. Okay, we're even now. Definitely should be seeing another up right around the corner. Okay, there you go. 3. I should see at least 4 up. Okay, pick the devil. And I'll be lucky if I get 5. A little bit lucky. I think the statistically it's a 4.5 up. Okay. Well, I got 4. So I got 4 out of 36. It's still making currency. It's definitely making currency overall. But it's not crazy. I mean, if you guys think I'm lucky there or not, but definitely not very lucky there. All right, so that is it. Gambling session done, and this video I already know is like well over an hour at this point. So I'm going to get into the final thoughts that I have for you. I mean, I stand by what I said. Most lucrative farm of the league, I think this is. Honestly, whether it's 25 or 20 or 30 divines an hour, I think you'll find if you take a magic find character, a really strong character, a hybrid character, a very fast character, like mine, you go in there and just absolutely cut loose in the Crimson Temple with fully spec'd Harbingers, almost fully spec'd strong boxes, not counting Elevated Sexton, I guess. Or by all means, try it with the Elevated Sexton. And yeah, I mean, you're just going to be pulling crazy amount of currency out there with or without Apothecary drops, by the way. You have a chance to get a mirror shard, which could convert it into a raw mirror. You got a very decent chance of finding a Tier 0 unique. I must have seen at least 1,000 unique leather and or heavy belts during this time. So, you know, if ever you were going to find a unique Mage Blood or Headhunter just raw on the ground, it's a farm like this. So that's another massive jackpot hit. I already mentioned earlier, you could find a duplicated House of Mirrors, Unrequited Love, something like that. One of the major random divination cards out of a Diviner's Strongbox. You could find a duplicated mirror out of an Arcanist Strongbox. I mean, there's been highlights on Reddit of that as well. And, of course, pure fractured orbs can drop off the boss. Had a very decent chance of seeing that. The Divine Orb Altar certainly has a fairly high chance of spawning in here. There's a lot of altars in here. At least the same chance you would at any other given Eater of Worlds map. And that's not even it. That's not even all the farms. I guess the Wild Cat spawns off Delirium bosses. And, you know, we do see some of those in here. So I've been told. So it's going to be a lot of fun. And for that reason, because it's so much fun, it's very high-end investment, and because high-end investment is more lucrative than it's ever been, at least relative to the cost, in the investment cost, I feel motivated enough to do 1,000 runs like this. Probably exactly the same tree. I might change a few little things here or there, but I am totally prepared to use 4,000 winged scarabs in a row to see what becomes of it, because it's just so much chasing here. I mean, the Tier 0 uniques, the mirrors, the apothecaries, the random div cards, just so much. It's actually kind of crazy how many different chase things are going on here. And it's not like, you know, skittering deli web farming, click, 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 gotta click everything and break your index finger to get in and out of the map. I don't want to do 1,000 maps like that. I want to do 1,000 maps like this. It's definitely a lot more fun. So look forward to me starting on that at some point soon. First, I will showcase how I farm the 8-mod corrupted maps. I know a lot of people have been asking, how do you even get all these 8-mod corrupted maps? There was a very specific strategy I used for that. It is akin to the strategy that I used last league on the Colonnade. You can look back last league on one of my videos. I did a 100 maps showcase on that. It's going to be quite similar to that. A little different. Different enough that I think I'll make another video on it. But yeah, I think this is at least up to a 30 divine strat on the low end. You know, the low end definitely can be kind of low, but things average out. So we'll see what becomes of it. If you have any questions, please ask in the description below. One more, another subscribe there Inscrutable. Thanks, buddy. That's about it. Mind's gone blank. I can't think of anything else there is to add, and this video is now done. So, I'll see you guys next time. Thank you.